Today, we're going to be talking about the physical cost of time and energy, something that many of us would say we don't have enough of. However, if you serve in any area of leadership, whether at work, in the church, or in a community association, you know how much time and energy it takes to keep that organization pointed in the right direction and moving forward. It can be truly exhausting. That's, of course, on a normal year. This year has been a massive challenge for every leader. Ask any manager or director, supervisor or shop foreman, pastor or board member, and they'll tell you that over the past year, their time and energy has been depleted to an extent that they've never felt before. This is why it's so important in this moment to thank our leaders. Today, as we begin this journey, looking at the physical cost of time and energy, we're going to start by thanking those who have given so much of it this past year to Mountain View Church. I want to start by thanking three women in particular who have served over this strange year and who will be taking a well-deserved break from leadership this coming year. We want to thank our hospitality director, Megan Lee, who has stepped down from hospitality ministry, although you'll still see her volunteering on occasion in our weekly film package. We want to thank our music director, Elizabeth Ashenko, who will be taking a break at the end of March with a new baby on the way, which is really exciting. And we want to thank our board secretary, Esther McNeil, who has served for many years in a number of leadership capacities, ending her term on the board this April. If you know any of these three amazing women, please send them a text or an email today, or give them a call and thank them for the massive amounts of time and energy they have sacrificed to lead in their areas of ministry. Lastly, I'd be remiss if I didn't thank our other leaders who continue to sacrifice their time and energy for Mountain View Church in this current moment. I want to thank our elders, Mark Shore, who also serves as our board chair, and Adam Lindsay, who also serves as one of our board directors. I want to thank our other board members, our vice chair, Phil Willoughby, our treasurer, Sarah Geary, and our directors, Chan Kim and Adam Barrett. I want to thank our staff and ministry team as well. Thank you to our office manager, Cornelia Brenner, our children's director, Megan Clausen, our junior youth director, Allison Ott, our facilities director, Aaron Moness, our missions directors, Karen Pregasser and Nancy Lewis, our tech director, Brian Walter, and our sound and media tech, Tuan Nguyen. If you're able to and willing, take some time to drop one of these people a text or an email, thanking them for sacrificing their time and energy to see our mission to introduce, baptize, and teach people to follow Jesus fulfilled in this city of Whitehorse and beyond.
I believe in the Holy Spirit. believe in God our Father. I believe in Christ the Son. I believe in the Holy Spirit. Our God is three in one. I believe in the resurrection, that we will rise again. For I believe in the name of Jesus. I believe.
It's a new week and it's a new episode in our series, The Good Samaritan. My name is Katarina and this is Mountain View Church. So glad you're choosing to attend our gathering, either in person or from your couch or on the go. As every day is getting a little bit more light, we pray that you too would feel more hope and be encouraged by Jesus' presence in your life. We would love to connect with you. You can find us on social media or go to our website, MountainviewWhitehorse.ca, hit connect and let us know who you are, your thoughts or feedback, how we can pray for you, and how we might serve you better. And if you enjoy our content, we would love for you to spread the word. Go ahead and hit that like button, or better yet, click on invite or share and pass the link on to a friend. Finally, we are so grateful for all the financial support we get from people such as you. Thank you. This is what really helps sustain the work we do. If you have never made a donation, it is really easy to do so. Text GIVE to the number on the screen, or head to our website, click on GIVE, or if you're here in person, you can feel free to drop your gift into the mailbox at the back of the auditorium. We pray that you will be blessed by this today. Thanks for watching.
Hey everyone, hope it's been a great week. First off, let's talk about Family Day. That was amazing, guys. It was such a wonderful time, and it was so good to see everyone who came out. So thank you. I sure hope everyone enjoyed it. Stay tuned for our next big event.
Just between you and me, it's going to be Easter.
As for this week, in-house, this is a parent-led space. This means one parent needs to be downstairs with the child. All the lessons and activities that I'm about to cover will be available downstairs to do as a family, so come check it out. Explorers and scramblers, who has ever rolled or splashed in the mud? Imagine, you're covered from head to toe in mud. Now what are you going to do? Who is going to touch you and help you get that stink off? P.U. Well, this is exactly what Jesus did. Jesus washed his disciples' muddy, stinky, gross feet to show how to serve one another. But even better than getting all that mud off, he washes us from our sins and makes us clean on the inside. Check out this week's lesson to learn how Jesus cleans all of us. Campers, we are starting a new series with Connect HQ called I Matter. This is the first week and it's all about finding what you are good at. God has given us each a special gift, something that we are good at and usually enjoy very much. So with this gift, what are we to do with it? Keep it all to ourselves? Use it to make ourselves better than others? Or are we to use it to serve others and give God glory? Well, in the Bible, it tells us that each of us has received a gift in order to serve others. So that is how God wants us to use our gifts. Be sure to watch this week's video to learn more. Climbers. What do you spend your time and energy on? What do you daydream about the most? What do you talk about the most? If you have the same answer to all those questions, then that shows you what you worship in your life. While it may not be a bad thing, God doesn't want anything to take priority over Him. He does this to protect us from ourselves. You see, by putting your energy and trust and hope in something other than God, you will be let down. It may not be right away, but at some point it will fall. It'll leave you empty-handed. However, if we put God at the top, He will never let us down. He will never leave us empty-handed. Learn more about this in this week's video. Junior youth, you guys, you still have time to invite your friends to the next gathering, which will be March 20th, which is the third Saturday in the month, from 7 to 8:30 p.m. Text the number below for more details. I hope you have had a wonderful week. And before I close, I'd like to take a moment and pray. Dear Heavenly Father, thank you for sending Jesus to show us examples of how to love others, but also for his love for us to die for our sins. Thank you for giving us all a gift, and may you help us see how we can best use it. And I ask that you please show us what we put as priority over you, so we can look to change that and make you our priority. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
This is a house of worship. This is a place of praise, where every demon trembles, where we proclaim your name. This is a house of healing. Our hearts are full of faith. You have our full attention. You have the final say. There's resurrection power. Your blood flows through our veins. Your kingdom triumphs over even the coldest grave. Come alive in the name of
I'm reading from Luke 10, verses 25 to 37, the parable of the Good Samaritan. And behold, a lawyer stood up to put him to the test, saying, "Teacher, "What shall I do to inherit eternal life?" He said to him, "What is written in the law? How do you read it?" And he answered, "You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul and with all your strength and with all your mind, and your neighbor as yourself." And he said to him, "You have answered correctly. Do this and you will live." But he, desiring to justify himself, said to Jesus, "And who is my neighbor?" Jesus replied, "A man was going down from Jerusalem to Jericho, and he fell among robbers, who stripped him and beat him and departed, leaving him half dead. Now by chance, a priest was going down that road, and when he saw him, he passed by on the other side. So likewise a Levite, when he came to the place and saw him, passed by on the other side. But a Samaritan, as he journeyed, came to where he was, and when he saw him, he had compassion. He went to him and bound up his wounds, pouring on oil and wine. Then he set him on his own animal and brought him to an inn and took care of him. And the next day he took out 2 denarii and gave them to the innkeeper, saying, 'Take care of him, and whatever more you spend, I will repay you when I come back.' Which of these three do you think proved to be a neighbor to the one who fell among the robbers?" He said, "Well, the one who showed him mercy." And Jesus said to him, "You go and do likewise."
In week 2 of our series based on the parable, The Good Samaritan, looking at the cost of loving our neighbors. This is one of the most popular, most well-known parables, both inside and outside the church, that Jesus ever told. And over the next 4 weeks, we're going to be looking at the financial cost, which we looked at last week. This week, we're going to look at the physical cost, the time and energy. Next week, we're going to look at the social cost, and then the last week, the cultural cost. If you missed last week, you're going to want to pause this right now, go back to the previous episode and watch it, because we talked a lot about cultural, historic stuff that really laid a foundation for us understanding what Jesus is talking about in this parable. So, assuming that you already watched episode 1, we're going to continue on this week in the physical cost of loving your neighbor, the sacrifice of time and energy related to this parable. Grab your Bibles if you have one. If you have a print Bible and you're unsure how to look things up, you can go to the table of contents in the front and you're going to look for Luke. We're going to go to Luke and then you're going to go to chapter 10, the big numbers there. And we're going to start small numbers at 25, Luke 10, 25. And if you don't have a print Bible, but you have a mobile device, you can go ahead and download a Bible app and then search Luke 10, 25, and you'll get there. Okay. Thank you so much to Allison for reading our parable this week. Each week, we're going to have a different reader reading the parable. You're going to become very familiar with it, maybe even have it memorized, which is a beautiful thing. Okay. So we want to talk about this lawyer again, this guy who challenges Jesus, trying to justify himself. And in Luke 10, verse 25, In 29, we see that the lawyer stood up to put him to the test, saying, "Teacher, what shall I do to inherit eternal life?" And then in verse 29, he says to him, trying to justify himself, he says, "Who is my neighbor? Who is my neighbor? Who is the one in my community? Who's my people?" This is what he wants to ask Jesus. Who should he be close to? Who should he sacrifice for? Who should he give to and spend time with? This is all the questions we're unpacking during this series. Now, the lawyer, a reminder that he's an expert of the Mosaic Law, the first five books of the Bible. Sometimes in scripture, the lawyer is referred to as a scribe. They're skilled in interpreting and applying the scriptures, the Old Testament scriptures of Moses. Now, in our world today, we might refer to this lawyer or this scribe as a theologian. This would be someone who has a doctorate in theology. And if we think about that, by challenging Jesus, he's not really doing the wrong thing. This lawyer is probably doing his job. As a lawyer, scribe, as a keeper of the Old Testament law, the Mosaic law, he would have to kind of check out supposed prophets or rabbis like Jesus, these teachers, check them out to make sure they're doing what they should. This is if we take away the heart condition that Jesus could clearly see in this man. But wait a second, why didn't Jesus, in this parable that we've been studying the past couple weeks and we'll continue, why didn't he use an example of a lawyer walked by? Because we learned last week it was a priest, a Levite, a Samaritan that walked by to help this Jewish man that had been left half dead. Why not a lawyer? Wouldn't that have made sense? Well, actually, as we're going to find out today, it wouldn't have made sense. And there's a great reason why Jesus would have not said a lawyer passed by. And we're going to look at that today regarding time and energy, the time and energy it takes to help someone. Okay, let's talk about this journey from Jerusalem to Jericho, because in verse 30, we get a picture. Jesus tells this parable that there was a certain man, a Jewish man, was going down from Jerusalem to Jericho. He fell among robbers who stripped him and beat him and departed, leaving him half dead. Okay, this is the start of our parable. But we haven't really got into this journey, this road from Jerusalem to Jericho. He was going down from Jerusalem to Jericho. What did that look like? Why was he going on this road? And this is important. This road was actually 18 miles long, and it descended 3,200 feet, having a reputation as very dangerous, a dangerous route to travel. Now, this is an entirely normal thing. Jericho was a fertile place that people farmed and they made things and they lived and worked, and they would go to Jerusalem to sell things, trade, barter, these different things. And so this road was traveled, but it was treacherous. And so this Jewish man likely has traveled from Jericho to Jerusalem, and he has sold some things, traded some things, and he's on his way back from Jerusalem to Jericho, which is probably why he has a pocket full of cash. And these robbers would know people coming back from trading, selling, they're going to have money on them. And so this is a believable story. Jesus telling this parable, we need to understand, in the first century, this is something that might have happened. This would have happened. A couple writers say it this way. I want to read a couple quotes. James Edwards in the Pillar New Testament Commentary writes it this way. "The elevation of Jerusalem is 2,600 feet above sea level, and Jericho, 18 miles to the northeast, lies 825 feet below sea level. Despite its arid and desolate surroundings, Jericho was a verdant, fertile, and productive oasis of date palms. The serpentine road from Jerusalem to Jericho descended 3,400 feet through steep and rugged hill country, pockmarked with caves, which, especially near the ascent to Jerusalem, offered refuge for brigands," a word for robbers and bandits. The American Bible Society talks about it this way, this road. They state, "Although Jericho is northeast of Jerusalem, travelers go down to Jericho. Such a dramatic change in height brought with it a startlingly rapid shift in environmental conditions that must have proven exhausting for anyone making the journey. Even without the ever-present threat of bandits, it was a precipitously arduous, dry, and dangerous trek. So if we go back to our main theme, this cost of time and energy, we need to understand that this road is a doozy. It, in a normal circumstance, not even, forget about the bandits, forget about that risk. This is a rough, long journey that people would only take in order to, it's got to be worthwhile. They got to sell stuff, trade stuff. It's a key link between two important cities, Jerusalem and Jericho. And so this unnamed man, he has traveled. And again, it makes sense that if he had traded or sold kind of what he had, maybe sold his wares, whatever they are, in Jerusalem, he's headed back to Jericho, pockets full of money, ready to give to his family, maybe buy other things. This is probably how he made his living in this journey every few weeks, few months. And so he's beaten up, robbed, left for dead. And so this is important for us to know, especially when, by the end of the message, when we get to the Samaritan again, we need to keep in context, okay, this road, because the Samaritan was traveling this road too. And wait a second, so was the priest and Levite. Why were they traveling this road too? What's it all about? Okay, so the priest that passed by. Remember in verse 31, we read that now by chance a priest was going down the road, and when he saw him, the man lying there half dead, he passed by on the other side. Now we may be tempted. We can read our thoughts and feelings into a parable, and we do. You may have thought this too. I like the idea that this is just some lazy priest that's ignoring someone, that he could be making an effort. And maybe you've thought that too, but that's not true. That's not correct. That's actually us reading into the text. If we're to go back to understanding what a priest did and what their lives consisted of, we would never think a priest was lazy. We would understand they actually work very hard. These priests, keep in mind, they have to deal with the chaos of the temple. We got masses of people. We got masses of animals, because this is sacrificial systems here, and following God's law and making sure everything's organized, the facilitation of the sacrifices, and anything from butchering and the burning and distributing of meat. And there's so many things that go into this. If you just read the first five books of the Bible, read some of the law in there and all the things they had to follow in regards to this sacrificial system. It was exhausting work. Never mind. Think of the masses of people. Think of opinions, conflicts, complaints, all day long trying to make sure everything's in order so that they can keep in right standing with God. This was a big, big responsibility. If we talk about the daily time and energy that these priests took in their career, their calling, it was a lot. Dr. Shane Cohen writes it this way. There would be extra teams of priests, rotations of priests who would come up to Jerusalem. They would be working in the temple, and it was on their shoulders that the ultimate responsibility for the correctness of this unbelievably frenzied scene would rest. It would be physically exhausting work. Okay, now we have a little bit of picture. This isn't just some lazy priest that's just having a walk in the wilderness that happens to say, oh, I don't want to bother with this guy. If he's part of the extra priest that's coming up from Jericho to help in Jerusalem because of just the massive amounts of work, this was a normative thing in the first century, he had a place to go. Or if he was coming back from Jerusalem, it doesn't really say exactly which way he was walking, just that he passed on the other side of the road. He would have just had an exhausting day, but more like he had spent a few days, and he's exhausted. He's worn out, and he's got to take this trip. He's got to go back to his family. He's got to rest, because who knows when his next shift is going to be called in and that he's going to have to go do this exhausting job again. You see, we can't assume that Jesus chooses a lazy person that didn't have anything to do or anywhere to go. That would be too easy. That's the point. Jesus' first person that he chooses is actually someone who is busy, who doesn't have the time, and who is exhausted, who has a lot to do, does not have the time or energy to help this guy. That's how culture would view this priest. Yes, high standing. Yes, important, an important spiritual and religious figure in their society, but busy. He had a lot to do and exhausted. But what about the Levites? Because remember, there's a Levite that comes by here, right? In verse 32. So likewise, a Levite, when he came to the place and saw him, passed by on the other side. So it's a priest and then a Levite. Again, maybe you're thinking, I wonder if Levites are lazy. Maybe he's got nothing to do, nowhere to go, and he could have stopped, but he didn't. Unfortunately, if we read the law, if we understand the historical context, it's not true. In actuality, the Levites were almost like the grunt workers working for the priests. They did a lot of the work that the priests didn't really want to do, or the less honorable or less notable jobs, kind of supporting staff, so to speak. Right? If we look at Dr. Jonathan Stokiew, he says this: Levites were not regarded as highly as priests. They are often described as a lower level priesthood. They manned the temple gates, cleaned the temple, slaughtered some of the sacrificial animals, and performed music during temple worship. Okay, wait a second. So now we're going to get a picture of the Levites. So if he's headed to Jerusalem, he's headed to take a shift. Maybe he gets to play some music. That sounds okay. But he also, is he the one that cleans the temple? Imagine the amount of blood and guts, and imagine this. I know it's not nice to maybe picture, but this is a sacrificial system. All these animals, these Levites, they must have worked incredibly hard to keep the temple clean after all these sacrifices. They had a rough job. They had a rough life. An honorable one, serving God in that capacity. They're looked up in their heritage and bloodline as Levites. It's a beautiful thing. But again, we're left realizing, okay, Levites, in that culture, they weren't just this lazy group that had plenty of time to help someone. When they passed by, when this Levite passed by, he clearly was either headed to Jerusalem to do his work, his hard work, or he's exhausted and he doesn't have the time and the energy right now. He's got to get home to Jericho because he doesn't know when his next shift or hitch of work is going to start. This is important. It's important for us to understand that the two people Jesus chose as examples to pass by, culture would have understood. They're important people, but they're also busy people, hardworking people, people that sacrifice their time and energy for God's work. But what about the Samaritan? Again, we come back to the scripture, and in verse 33, but a Samaritan, as he journeyed, came to where he was, and when he saw him, he had compassion. How much time and energy did this Samaritan have? Where's he going? Where's he coming from? Why is he there? Why is he passing? Now, it's a parable. It's a fictitious story that Jesus is using to tell a principle, a lesson. However, he's choosing something that was common, that would have happened. Samaritans definitely traveled that road as well as Jews, although they keep in mind these folks are enemies, like we talked about last week. But let's also remember that Samaritans are outcast people group. Remember, we talked about some of those nasty names that they were called, half-breeds, heathen or heretic, and devil, demon. Like, these are some of the things that they're referred to because they're this mixed tribe of people, not full Jewish blood. And so they're less than social outcasts. Now let's think about that. They probably traveled just as much and worked just as hard as the man who actually was laying dead. A Samaritan, maybe he lived in Jerusalem outside, or maybe Jericho. But keep in mind that if they were going to go sell something in Jerusalem or trade something, it's going to be a little harder when you're a Samaritan. You're maybe not going to get the best price. Maybe you're going to have to work a little harder to barter. And the jobs that you did and the work you did, you were in your own community, maybe outside of the city. Maybe you did, you know, farming, herding of sheep or cattle. It's hard to really know. Samaritans did all sorts of different jobs, but we have to understand that if we compare the average Jew at that time to the average Samaritan and the work they did and the money they could get paid, a Samaritan probably had to work a little harder. Life was a little tougher for the social outcast. If we think about the road and the risk and the danger and the bandits and just the different climate and environment, if we think about all of this that we learned at the start, This Samaritan had to endure all that too. It's not like he had more time or energy. We see that all three characters actually were all really busy. They were all probably exhausted, and none of them had the time really to stop and help this man. But that's the point. This is why we're talking about the physical cost of loving our neighbor. It's about sacrifice. The Samaritan chose to sacrifice the lack of time and energy he had when the priest and the Levite didn't. And this time, last week we talked about finances, and he gave his possessions and his belongings and money to show mercy and compassion. But this time we're looking at the time and energy that he gave. He must have been depleted, because to think about, oh, well, maybe he just had the spare time, or maybe he had a boost of energy. It doesn't look like that. It doesn't sound like that. He had to make a choice in an already difficult journey, in an already exhausting world, exhausting life, which was the first century for everyone. Let's just be realistic. He had to make the choice when he was likely depleted to deplete himself more to show love and mercy and compassion. And this is the point that Jesus is getting at. Jesus is telling us a parable about a guy who happened to sacrifice that time and energy. He didn't happen to have it. It wasn't extra. He didn't have any of that. He gave up his journey. He gave up where he was going. He gave up what he had to do, which was probably easier. He chose the harder path, which was to help this man in need. And so for us, if we think about this, we need to remember the original question. Remember the original question. In verse 25, the lawyer that tested Jesus, he started by saying, he wanted to know, "Teacher, what shall I do to inherit eternal life?" That's the original question. And when we keep that in mind and we go back through this, we start to see that Jesus is painting this deeper picture, the deeper meaning of being a disciple in the kingdom. That following Jesus, abiding in Jesus, belonging to Jesus takes sacrifice. And again, we talked about last week, Christians sacrificing for other Christians, the world isn't going to be shocked at that. If anything, I think the world would probably say, I expect Christians to take care of their own. But this is the huge shift with the Good Samaritan. The Good Samaritan helps his enemy, helps the one that's least likely to receive his mercy and compassion. And so for us, the bigger picture, to follow Jesus isn't just about giving our money and possessions to those in need outside of the Christian community. This is also about giving maybe the hardest thing, which is our time and energy. What does it look like when Christians give their time and energy to show mercy and compassion to the outside world? What message does it say to the outside world? What do they start thinking of us? See, that's radical love. That's Good Samaritan love, radical mercy and compassion. That's what we need to be pursuing. And this is what Jesus is bringing to the surface. And here's the craziest part. The craziest part when we sacrifice our time and energy for Jesus is the more we sacrifice for him, the closer we feel connected to him. I want to say that again. The more we sacrifice for him, the closer we feel to him. And I get it. Maybe you've asked. As a pastor, I've heard it before. People say, oh, I can't get close to Jesus. I don't feel the Spirit's presence. You know, how can I feel more connected to God? And then I start asking questions about their life, and I realize, you're not doing anything. I'm sorry to say, you're just not doing anything. Netflix, over and over, hours and hours, episodes and episodes, will not get you better connected to Jesus. At some point, if you want to feel connected to Jesus, you got to do something. And I just want to ask, when's the last time you served or volunteered? Not just in Mountain View Church. Let's move past that. What about the food bank, the shelter? If you're a woman, when's the last time you served at the women's transition home? You see, these are all ways where we are serving and volunteering. We are sacrificing time and energy for those in need. And what you'll find is that you feel closer connected to Jesus because you're starting to live out his mission. You're living out what he's calling us to in this parable. You're going outside the doors of the church to serve our city. And you might want to think, I get it. You might think, oh, well, Jeremy, if I had the time or if I had the energy, I'd do it. But this is what this parable blows out of the water. None of these people had the time or the energy. And yet the Samaritan chose to sacrifice it. You see, unless we make it a priority, an act, or at least put it in the calendar, it's not going to happen. If you're waiting for the time or energy, this world will suck it out of you. You will not have it left. Months will pass by and you'll say, I wish I had of fill in the blank. Before I pray, I want to read a quote from an unnamed author that works for a ministry titled Samaritan's Purse, an organization that gives generously, that definitely sacrifices a lot to help those in the developing world. And so I want to read this quote to you because it really beautifully sums up exactly what we're talking about, this cost, this sacrifice of time and energy, and how close we can belong to Jesus when we make the choice to lay down our time and energy. Check this out. Our honor and joy as Christians is to love others as Christ loved us, through sacrifice. It costs money, time, energy, and pride, among other things. Sometimes it's dangerous. Other times it hurts. But when you compare the cost to what you gain in return, the choice is clear. Because of Christ, we don't have to maintain a death grip on everything we care about. The Savior has set us free to serve with our resources and ourselves. It's a wonderful and mysterious paradox where the more you give away, the more you have. We don't have to look far to find hurting people, but we do have to be willing to sacrifice our time and lovingly meet the needs of others. As ambassadors for Christ in this world, few things matter more than this. Let's pray. Dear Father, I thank you for this parable once again. I thank you for the challenge that all the characters in this story were busy, like we are. And yet only one sacrificed that time and energy. May we consider this week. May we put it in our calendar. May we choose to act. Make a conscious decision, not waiting for the time to arrive, but choosing to act like the Good Samaritan did. Choosing to move away from the regular schedule, the regular path, and to get involved in the mess. May we choose to get involved in the mess this week. Bring to us people in need, that as a church we might serve this city and beyond. And that people would know that Christ followers, that Christians aren't just about themselves. We're about the lost. We're about Jesus' work, his gospel. And we want to serve them. We want to show them mercy and compassion. Give us a burden for the lost. As we see our neighbors, the people in our community that maybe we don't get along with, the people groups outside of our normal community, may we see them the way you see them and love them. We ask all this in Jesus' name. Amen. Okay, discussion group questions. Whether you're in-house here, gather in a bubble group, or you're at home, gathered with someone, that's awesome. If you're online, you can drop your comments and questions and feedback in the comments below in whatever platform you're using, and someone will probably dialogue with you. And so that's a beautiful thing. The first discussion question is to take a time on it. Take a time audit of this week or this past month. How much time and energy have you spent on people outside of your family, friends, and or church community? Okay, it's a tough one. Think about all the time you've spent. How much time have you given? How much time and energy have you given to people outside of your family, friends, and church community? It's a time audit. Then once you've done that audit, it's time to make a plan. In your group or your household. How will your group or household show mercy and compassion through sacrificing time and energy this week? How will your group or household show mercy and compassion through sacrificing time and energy this week? All right, thank you so much for tuning in. Come back next week as we look at the social cost. What does it mean socially for this Good Samaritan to help this man who's half dead? And then what does it mean for us? What is Jesus calling us to as followers of Jesus, how we socially interact with society? All right, it's a big topic. Can't wait for it. Thank you.